Hi, good evening. This is Elizabeth Chua Tapuan. Again, I'm promoting this Trinity Cares Health Concert to encourage people to, especially those who are already Christians, to go out and make disciples of all nations. And that's the commission, that's the mission of Christians, and I believe that, and we have a great opportunity to serve. And so remember that it seems impossible. How can you really reach out to all nations? That's why I applaud the missionaries, the evangelists, the pastors, the priests, the nuns, you know, the brothers. They sacrifice so many things, and it seems impossible, but it is possible. So now let us remember this song of Mission Impossible, but nothing's impossible with God. You must remember that. And so let us see.
Chapter 28. Went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said,
"All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, to the very end of the age."
So you see, Jesus was given the authority in heavens and in earth. And he has given the disciples to go and preach to all creatures. And it seems like for the past few days, I've been opening my Bible to this great commission. First it was Luke, then Mark, and then now it's Matthew. And so it seems it's really urgent that the Lord is telling me, telling you, especially the believers, to go and preach the gospel. And for me, it's first you have to start with yourself. You have to believe and really internalize a teaching. And because we can easily be dissuaded with some teasing, some temptations, but really, it's really, there's really an urgency. Now, let us look into this overview.
He says, "Who do you all say that I am?" And Peter comes up with the right.
Hold on. This is not the one I'm looking for first.
and links it.
Let us see. Matthew. I like this overview because it gives us a whole picture of St. Matthew's Gospel, because they have differences, and it's only about 8 minutes. Let's see.
The Gospel according to Matthew. It's one of the earliest official accounts about Jesus of Nazareth, his life, his death, and his resurrection. The book itself is anonymous, but the earliest reliable tradition links it to Matthew the tax collector, who was one of the 12 apostles that Jesus appointed, and he actually appears within the book itself. For about 30 to 40 years, the apostles orally taught and passed on their eyewitness accounts about Jesus, along with his teachings that they had all memorized. And Matthew has then collected and arranged all these into this amazing tapestry and designed the book to highlight certain themes about Jesus. In this video, we're just going to cover the first half of the book. Specifically, Matthew wants to show how Jesus is the continuation and fulfillment of the whole biblical story about God and Israel. That Jesus is the Messiah from the line of David, that he is a new authoritative teacher like Moses, and not only that, Jesus is God with us, or in Hebrew, Emmanuel. And Matthew's designed this book with an introduction and then a conclusion, and these act like a frame around five clear sections right here in the center, each of which concludes with a long block of Jesus' teaching. Now, this design is very intentional, and it's amazing. Just watch how this works. Chapters 1 through 3, they set the stage by attaching Jesus' story right onto the storyline of the Old Testament scriptures. So Matthew opens with a genealogy about Jesus that highlights how he is from the messianic line of the son of David, and he's a son of Abraham. That means he's going to bring God's blessing to all of the nations. After that, we get the famous story about Jesus' birth and how all of the events fulfilled the Old Testament prophetic promises, that the nations would come and honor the Messiah, that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem, but even more than that, Jesus' conception by the Holy Spirit, his name Emmanuel, all these work together to show that Jesus is no mere human. He is God with us, God become human. So you can see two of Matthew's key themes right here in the introduction. He's from the line of David, he's Emmanuel. But Matthew also wants to show how Jesus is a new Moses. So like Moses, Jesus came up out of Egypt. He passed through the waters of baptism, and he entered into the wilderness for 40 days. And then Jesus goes up onto a mountain to deliver his new teaching. So through all of this, Matthew is claiming that Jesus is the promised greater than Moses figure who's going to deliver Israel from slavery. He's going to give them new divine teaching. He's going to save them from their sins and bring about a new covenant relationship between God and his people. This Moses and Jesus parallel also explains why Matthew has structured the center of the book the way that he did. These five main parts highlight Jesus as a teacher, and he's created a parallel. Jesus as a teacher parallels the five books of Moses. Jesus is the new authoritative covenant teacher who's going to fulfill the storyline of the Torah. Now, in the first section, chapters 4 to 7, Jesus steps onto the scene announcing the arrival of God's kingdom, and this is really key. The kingdom is, in essence, about God's rescue operation for his whole world, and it's taking place through King Jesus. Jesus has come to confront evil, especially spiritual evil, and its whole legacy of demon oppression and disease and death. Jesus has come to restore God's rule and reign over the whole world, by creating a new family of people who will follow him, obey his teachings, and live under his rule. So, after Jesus begins healing people and forming a movement, a community, he takes his followers out to a mountain or a hillside, and he delivers his first big block of teaching, traditionally called the Sermon on the Mount. And here Jesus explores what it looks like to follow him and live in God's kingdom. And it's an upside-down kingdom where there are no privileged members. So the poor, the nobodies, the wealthy, the religious, everybody is invited and is called to turn, to repent, and to follow Jesus and join his family. Jesus says that he's not here to set aside the commands of the Torah or the Old Testament. Rather, he's here to fulfill all of that through his life, through his teachings. He's here to transform the hearts of his people so that they can truly love God and love their neighbor, including their enemy. After concluding his great teaching on the kingdom, the next section shows Jesus bringing the kingdom into reality in the day-to-day lives of people. So Matthew's arranged here 9 stories about Jesus bringing the power of God's kingdom into the lives of hurting, broken people. There are 3 groups of 3 stories, and they're all about people who are sick or have broken bodies or they're in danger, and Jesus heals or saves them by these acts of grace and power. And then right in between these triads, we find 2 parallel stories about Jesus' call that people should follow him. Matthew's making a point here. One can only experience the power of Jesus' grace by following him and becoming his disciple. Now, after Matthew has shown the power of the kingdom through Jesus, Jesus then extends his reach by sending out the 12 disciples who are going to go do what he's been doing. And this leads to the second large block of teaching, chapter 10. And here, Jesus teaches his disciples how to announce the kingdom and what to expect once they do. Many among Israel are accepting Jesus and his offer of the kingdom, but Israel's leaders, they aren't. They stand to lose a lot if they repent and become disciples of Jesus. And so Jesus knows they're going to reject him and persecute his followers, which is exactly what happens. In the next section, chapters 11 through 13, Matthew has collected a group of stories about how people are responding to Jesus and his message, and it's a mixed bag. So some stories are positive. People love Jesus and they think he's the Messiah. Others are more neutral, like John the Baptist, or even the members of Jesus' own family, and they make it clear that Jesus is not what they expected. And then you have Israel's leaders. They're entirely negative. You have the Pharisees and the Bible scholars. They all reject Jesus together. They think he's a false teacher. He's leading the people astray. They think he's blasphemous in these exalted claims he's making about himself. But Jesus isn't surprised or thrown by all these diverse responses. In fact, he focuses on it in the 3rd block of teaching, chapter 13. Here, Matthew's collected together a bunch of Jesus' parables about the kingdom, like about a farmer throwing seed on 4 types of soil, or about a mustard seed, or a pearl, or buried treasure. These parables are like a commentary on the stories that you've just read in chapters 11 and 12. Some people are accepting Jesus with enthusiasm. Others are rejecting him. But God's kingdom is of ultimate value, and it will not stop spreading despite all of these obstacles. So, that's the first half of the gospel according to Matthew. Now, here's a few more things to look for as you read through these chapters. Matthew's presenting Jesus, remember, as the continuation and fulfillment of the Old Testament storyline. So, look for how he weaves in quotations from the Old Testament scriptures. And what you'll find is that they're placed at strategic points in the story, explaining more about Jesus and his identity. So stop. Take time to go look up these references and read them in their Old Testament context. And most often, you'll discover really cool, interesting connections. Lastly, pay attention to the types of people who accept Jesus and follow him. And you'll see that it's most often people who are unimportant, they're nobodies, or they're irreligious. And these are the people who are transformed by their trust or faith in Jesus and follow him. And it's the religious and the prideful who are offended by him. So how is this tension between Jesus and Israel's leaders going to play itself out? That's what the second half of Matthew is all about. The Gospel according to Matthew. In the first video, we saw how Matthew introduced Jesus as the Messiah from the line of David and as a new authoritative teacher like Moses, and also as Emmanuel, which in Hebrew means God with us. After Jesus announced and taught about the arrival of God's kingdom, and after he brought the kingdom into day-to-day life among the people of Israel, we saw that Jesus was accepted by many, but rejected by others, especially Israel's religious leaders, the Pharisees. And so the big question is, how is this conflict between Jesus and Israel's leaders going to play itself out? The next large section, chapters 14 through 20, explore all the different expectations people have about the Messiah. So Jesus keeps healing sick people, and twice he even miraculously provides food for these huge crowds in the desert. One's made up of Jewish people, and the other is a non-Jewish crowd. And this sign, it's very similar to what Moses did for Israel in the wilderness. And so all these people are excited about Jesus. They think he's the great prophet and the Messiah, but not the religious leaders. Their view of the Messiah is built on passages like Psalm 2 or Daniel chapter 2 about a victorious Messiah who's going to deliver Israel and defeat the pagan oppressors. And from their point of view, Jesus, he's a false teacher, he's making blasphemous claims about himself, and so there are stories here about them increasing their opposition, hatching a plan to kill him. And so in response, Jesus, he withdraws. And he begins teaching his closest disciples what it means for him to be Israel's Messiah, because it is not what anybody expects. So Jesus asks his disciples, chapter 16, he says, "Who do you all say that I am?" And Peter comes up with the right answer, it seems. He says, "Well, you're the Messiah. You're the Son of the living God." But then it becomes clear that Peter's thinking about a king who's going to reign victoriously through military power. And Jesus challenges Peter, saying that, yes, I am going to become king, but through a different way. And so Jesus starts to teach on themes from the prophet Isaiah, who said that the messianic king would suffer and die for the sins of his own people. And so Jesus, he was positioning himself as a messianic king who reigns by becoming a servant and who would lay down his life for Israel and the nations. Well, Peter and the disciples, they mostly just don't get it. And so Jesus enters into the fourth block of teaching, followed by a series of teachings after that. And these are all about the upside-down nature of Jesus' messianic kingdom, which turns upside down all of our value systems. So in the community of the servant king, you gain honor by serving others. And instead of getting revenge, you forgive and do good to your enemies. And in Jesus' kingdom, you gain true wealth by giving your wealth away to the poor. To follow the servant Messiah, you must become a servant yourself. In the next section, we watch the two kingdoms clash, Jesus' kingdom and that of Israel's leader. Jesus comes to Jerusalem for Passover riding in on a donkey, and the crowds are hailing him as the Messiah. And Jesus immediately marches into the courtyard of the temple, and he creates this huge disruption that brings the daily sacrifices to a halt. His actions speak louder than words here. As Israel's king, Jesus was asserting his royal authority over the temple, the place where God and Israel met together. And in Jesus' view, the temple was compromised by the hypocrisy of Israel's leaders. And so here he's challenging their authority, and naturally, they're deeply offended. And so they try to trap Jesus and shame him in public debate, and they fail. So they end up just determining to have him killed. In response, Jesus delivers his final block of teaching. He first offers this passionate critique of the Pharisees and their hypocrisy. And then he weeps over Jerusalem and its rejection of God and his kingdom. Then Jesus withdraws with the disciples and he starts telling them what's going to happen. He's going to be executed by these leaders, but in doing so, they're going to create their own demise, because instead of accepting Jesus's way of the peaceful kingdom, they're going to take the road of revolt against Rome, and so Jerusalem and its temple are going to be destroyed. But, Jesus says, that is not the end of the story. He's going to be vindicated after his death by his resurrection. And one day, he'll return and set up his kingdom over all nations. And so in the meanwhile, the disciples need to stay alert and stay committed to just announcing Jesus and his kingdom and spreading the good news. And so with all of that ringing in the disciples' ears, the story comes to its climax. That night, Jesus takes the disciples aside and he celebrates a Passover meal with them. Passover retells the story of Israel's rescue from slavery through the death of the Passover lamb. And then Jesus takes the bread and the wine from this meal as new symbols, showing that his coming death would be a sacrifice that would redeem his people from slavery to sin and evil. After the meal, Jesus is arrested. He's put on trial before the Sanhedrin, a council of Jewish leaders. And they reject his claim to be the Messiah. They charge him with blasphemy against God. Then Jesus is brought before the Roman governor, Pilate, and he thinks Jesus is innocent, but he gives in to the pressure from the Jewish leaders, and he sentences Jesus to death by crucifixion. So Jesus is led away by Roman soldiers and crucified. Now, you'll notice right here in this section that just like Matthew did in the opening chapters, he increases the number of references to the Old Testament. He's trying to show that Jesus' death was not a tragedy or a failure. Rather, it was the surprising fulfillment of all of the old prophetic promises. Jesus came as the servant Messiah, spoken of by Isaiah. He was rejected by his own people, but instead of judging them, he is judged on their behalf, bearing the consequences of their sin. So the crucifixion scene, it comes to a close, and Jesus' body is placed in a tomb. But the book ends with a surprising twist, the last chapter. The disciples, they discover on Sunday morning that Jesus' tomb is empty. And then all of a sudden people start seeing Jesus alive from the dead. And the book concludes with the risen Jesus giving a final teaching called the Great Commission. Jesus says that he is now the true king of the world. And so he sends his disciples out to all nations with the good news that Jesus is Lord, and that anyone can join his kingdom by being baptized and by following his teachings. And echoing all the way back to his name, Emmanuel, God with us, from chapter 1, Jesus' last words in the book to his disciples are, "I will be with you." It's a promise of Jesus' presence until the day he finally returns. And that's the gospel according to Matthew.
Wow. It's so nice because he summarizes the whole book of Matthew. And so I've been following him because I think, they studied the Bible very well. And so it's also a learning process for me. But now, the thing that really strikes me is that for the past few days, I'm into this Great Commission, you know, that the Lord is really telling us to act, you know. You believe and then you also act. Now I'm just trying to fix this. The Great Commission has been mentioned in the several book, you know, the Gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And it seems like I opened the Bible on these chapters, on these verses, in the past few days. And so let us examine all of them. This Matthew, it's on Matthew 28 verses 16 to 20. And although there's differences in the way it is written, but basically we are on a mission. I am on a mission, you know. And I know I've just started, and I applaud those pastors, those who have been dedicating and trying to flood the social media with a mission to get people believe in Jesus, you know. And I hope I'm doing the same thing, you know. It's up to the Holy Spirit, because this has been I've been getting these verses So let's, we just heard about in Matthew 16, Matthew 28, verse 16 to 20. Let's just read it. 11 disciples went to Galilee according to the instruction of an angel, and later Jesus himself on the designated mountain. They saw Jesus, some worship him, others still doubted. Jesus says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, and therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all I have commanded." So first step is to have faith and then believe and practice what he teaches. And how do you do that unless you really read about his teaching? "And surely I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So Jesus, and even, you know, there's if two or more people gather together in my name, I am with them. So, and always try to, you know, like in the morning, try to invoke them. And then in Mark 16, 14 to 18, Jesus appeared to the 11 as they sat eating. Jesus accused them of unbelief because they did not believe those who had allegedly seen him after he had risen. Jesus said, "Go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature, every creature. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will drive out demons, they will speak in new tongues, they will pick up snakes with their hands, and they drink into deadly..." Oh my goodness. You see, this mouse is... because there's a button in the side, so anyway. "And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not harm them. They will lay their hands on the sick and they will be made well." Oh, I like that. Luke 24, verse 44 to 49. Jesus appeared in Jerusalem to the 11 disciples and others as they stood talking. Jesus repeated that everything written about him in the scriptures had to be fulfilled. "Jesus, this is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and in his name repentance and forgiveness of sins will be proclaimed to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But remain in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." Now in John 20, verse 19 to 23, Jesus appeared in Jerusalem to the disciples except Thomas, who were locked down in a house. Jesus wished them peace twice and said, "As the Father has sent me, so also I am sending you." Jesus blew the Holy Spirit over them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld and left." 4-8. Jesus taught the disciples for 40 days in Jerusalem. Jesus, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift the Father promised, which you have heard me discuss. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Disciples ask if Jesus would soon restore the kingdom to Israel. Jesus, it is not for you to know at times or season that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So this is the Great Commission. Christianity, Great Commission, is the instruction of the resurrected Jesus Christ to his disciples to spread the gospel to all nations of the world. It's outlined in Matthew 28, verse 16-20, as I have mentioned, where on the mountain in Galilee, Jesus calls on his followers to make disciples and baptize all nations in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Great Commission is similar to the episodes of the commissioning of the 12 apostles found other synoptic gospel. So now let us to spread the word. And there's even songs that have been written. Let us hear them. There's different. Let's hear this one. Another one. This is amazing. So much has been put in the social media, and here we just really have to share and do our part, you know. Much effort has been made, but we really have to spread it, share it, you know. And hopefully a lot of people will really see it, especially those who has not known Jesus, or we just have to keep on bringing people to Christ, you know. And I think that is the same mission. That's why San Antonio, you know, I've mentioned before that the mission churches in San Antonio, that was the ultimate goal, was to bring people to Christ. And it's amazing. They didn't only brought Christianity, but they also helped people improve their lives by giving them this they have these churches where they have quarters to where people and family live, and the Franciscan fathers taught them how to irrigate their lands, and they were taught to plant, you know, by self-sufficient. And there's this it's a short thing about San Antonio. It was part of the Great Commission. Let's play it. This is from Expedia. I found in YouTube.
Between the Mexican border and the Texan capital Austin sits historic San Antonio. It is the second most populated city in the Lone Star State and one of America's top travel destinations. San Antonio sprung up around 18th century bell towers of the Spanish missions. Today, the city's popular riverwalk connects these and many other iconic local attractions. Walk in the footsteps of the heroes of the Texas Revolution. Enjoy a festive atmosphere and experience the Latin culture. To give your feet a rest, cruise around in a river taxi or hop on and off vintage buses and trolleys. Linger on cafe terraces to try Tex-Mex or European food in between rides. A must-see is the Alamo, once a modest Franciscan mission and now a symbol of patriotism and defiance. In 1836, it became a fortress manned by a few hundred volunteers who bravely tried to hold back an invading army of thousands of Mexicans. They didn't die in vain. The Texans won independence that same year, shouting, "Remember the Alamo!" The nearby Institute of Texan Cultures takes you even further back in time. See how America's first peoples lived, and learn why the state has attracted immigrants from all over the globe ever since. Step inside the simple dwellings to catch a glimpse of early life in the Southwest. Catch the river taxi to the former 19th century brewery that is now the San Antonio Museum of Art. This impressive building houses everything from the Egyptian goddess Sekhmet and other ancient statues to depictions of local history on canvas. Back in the city center, there is always something going on in bustling Market Square. Listen to a heartfelt song, browse the stalls, or simply soak up the atmosphere. Take a short detour to the botanical gardens, with plants flourishing in the dry Texan desert. A far more lush experience is a stroll in the nearby Japanese tea gardens, with its amazing stone structures and the Jingu Tea House. This exotic attraction, just north of downtown in Brackenridge Park, is an oasis in this otherwise arid corner of the Southwest. In the same park is the Witte Museum. Let the children play before browsing the paintings and relics of San Antonio's past. Your passport to adventure is the nearby San Antonio Zoo. Good for some exciting wildlife encounters. Just a half hour drive from here, the residents in the Natural Bridge Wildlife Ranch have it made. The prairie and savanna animals here get to roam free within the park's boundaries. You can even feed some of the animals out of your hand during a self-drive safari. On a hot summer's day, there is nothing cooler than descending into the Natural Bridge Caverns just down the road. Follow the guide to a subterranean landscape of dripping stalactites and cathedral-like rock formations. Outside, the playground for kids and adults is something for the truly brave. Find your way back to the Riverwalk and explore La Vaida. Visit the craft markets around the old fountain or see a band in a riverside amphitheater. At the end of the day, ride the elevator to the top of the Tower of the Americas for a view you'll always remember. From the observation deck, San Antonio looks like a sparkling diamond under the night sky.
We have a mission. You can call it, our commission, which is, it's a mission possible because of Christ, you know, because the Holy Spirit would be moving with us. And so let's just take part, you know. Sometimes we just have to just click the button and share to the ends of the earth, you know, like the Franciscan fathers. They shared, not only shared the gospel, they also shared their thought, skills, and source of living. And so let's do it. Spread the word. It's just a click of a button and we would be able to do it. Get into my prayer.
Father, we believe in your Son, the Lord Jesus. We believe in your amazing love for us. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we recognize that we have a covenant with you. This new covenant was ratified by the shed blood of Jesus on the cross at Calvary. Right now, we acknowledge that Jesus bore our sins, our sicknesses, diseases, sorrows, griefs, fears, torments, unforgiveness, strife, and lack for us. Everything on that cross. Yes, Lord, we believe that Jesus' body was broken for us. His precious blood was shed on our behalf. We praise and thank you for Jesus. Glory to your name. By Jesus' stripes, we are healed. In every cell, in every organ, in every function of our body. Thanks to Jesus, our youth is renewed. With long life, you will satisfy us, Father. Through Jesus' sacrifice, we have total and complete redemption. We are totally delivered from the devil in every single way. We are new creations in Christ. Our freedom has been bought and paid for. Yes, we are forgiven. We are redeemed. We are free. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, we give you thanks. The Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." We will eat now. Thank you, Father. After the same manner also, he took the cup, which he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come." We take the cup in our hand and hold it up to you right now. Father, this represents the blood of the new covenant in which all our sins, past, present, and future, are all remitted. They are all forgiven through the blood of Jesus. Praise your holy name. Through his blood, we and our family are redeemed from every curse, every ancestral curse, from every single curse of the law. Thank you. We will drink now. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You're a good, good God. You gave up your Son to remove the barrier standing between you and us. Thank you so much, Father. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that above all else, you desire that we prosper and be in health even as our soul prospers. We declare a new dimension of health, a new level of faith, a new realm of energy and divine strength. We declare that we are living, walking testimonies to all those around us who are defeated in this world. We have victory and new life in Jesus. Oh, that the world would come to know you. Protect, preserve, bless, and reach every single person in our family and our friends. In the wonderful and precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. In your name, Lord Jesus Christ, I take authority and bind all powers and forces in the air and the ground, in the water, the underground, netherworld, nature, in fire and in men. You are the Lord over the entire universe, and I give you the glory for your creation. In your mighty name, Lord Jesus Christ, I bind all demonic forces that have come against all human beings, my family, my friends, my relatives, my acquaintances, and even enemies. And also the poor souls in purgatory and all those who are suffering right now, physically, mentally, and spiritually. Cover us with your precious blood that was shed for us on the cross. Mary, our Mother, receive your protection and intercession. The Sacred Heart of Jesus for us and our families. Surround us with your mantle of love to scourge the enemy. Saint Michael, our guardian angel, come defend us and our family against the evil ones that roam the earth. In your mighty name, Lord Jesus Christ, I bind and command all powers of evil to depart right now away from us, our homes, our land. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your faithful, compassionate God. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, fill our hearts with your holy gifts. Let our weakness be penetrated with thy strength this very day, that we may fulfill all our duties conscientiously, that we may do what is right and just. Let our charities be such as offend no one, hurt no one's feelings, so generous to pardon sincerely any wrong done to us. Assist us, Holy Spirit, in all the trials of life. Enlighten us in our ignorance, advise in our doubts, strengthen us in our weakness, help us in all need and embarrassment, protect us in temptations. Graciously hear us, O Holy Spirit, and pour thy light into our hearts, our soul, our mind. Assist us to live a holy life, to grow in goodness and grace. Amen. So let's do it. Let's go and share the word, spread the word. Sometimes just click of a button, just share, keep on sharing.